Welcome to our show, Ask Your Father, a show where we get to ask our priest the hard questions, the questions that are on our minds, the questions we never get to discuss. We have with us our usual priest. We have Father Chi. Welcome, Father.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Good to have you. Father Scott. Welcome, Father.
Thank you very much.
Welcome. Welcome. Glad to have you. This is our third show on marriage. Last time we had a young couple with us talking to us, asking the questions to the priest. That couple was married for a year, I believe. And today we are happy to have with us another couple. This is much more than 1 year marriage. We have a couple who have been married for 52 years. We're happy to have with us Ramon and Petty Cervantes, Mr. and Mrs. Cervantes. Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're very happy to have you.
Happy to be here.
We'd like to start off by asking you, how do you do it? 52 years. Tell us the secrets.
Well, you want to talk first?
Well, I'm a baptized Catholic.
Okay.
I served Mass. Belonged to the Boy Scouts, sang in the school choirs. But that was the depth of my faith, going to church on Sundays. But I married a young woman that loves to pray. That's the key word, prayer. And from the time that we got married, she made it quite clear, God must be the center of our lives. Whatever we do, we must pivot around God. And prayer has been our lives. Family prayer, going out over 40 years to whoever wants prayer, the rosary, and so on. And God enlightened me to support my wife. Instead of staying home, I accompany her on those prayer visits. People look at me thinking, well, we think that men don't pray anymore. It's all women and there's one man among them. But because we made God the center of our lives, and because we pray always, I think that God blessed us. God gave us that extra sense to understand the role of a husband and a wife. At this point, I would tell you that we went through it cold turkey. In Belize, cold turkey means you didn't have the marriage preparation programs that we have now that tells us that if you read the Bible, you will know everything about marriage. Everything about marriage comes from the Bible. First of all, it was instituted by God for the procreation of the human race, for the family life. Starting with Genesis, where God made Adam, and then he thought that Adam was lonely, and then he made Eve as his companion. And as you go through the Bible readings, for everything in marriage is a quotation from one of the people that wrote the Bible. And because we have had God at the center of our lives, no problem has been too big for us. There's no marriage that's perfect. We have had misunderstandings, but because we pray. For instance, if I have a misunderstanding with my wife, I would get the inspiration to, guess what, shut up. It takes two people to shout at each other. And I would pray. I would pray, God, please bring peace between me and my wife. Before we go to sleep. And I would like to tell all married couples, you'd be surprised what happens in that bed at night when God intervenes and you hug each other before you close your eyes. I will now leave the rest to my wife.
Yes, well said. Thank you, Raman. Good sharing. Yes, Betty.
Well, as my husband has said, I grew up with a mother that was very prayerful. And my father also. I grew up with a lot of prayer. My mother was always in rosaries and doing novenas, you know, to the Blessed Mother, to Esquipulas, and you name it. She was always there. So I was the youngest one in my family. And as a matter of fact, what I remembered about my dad, he wanted me to be a nun. And I had it all made up that I was going to be a nun. But the good Lord did not want me to be a nun. He wanted me to be a wife. And I must tell you that from the time we got married, as my husband said before, I said, God has to be the center of our life to be able to have a good marriage.
From day one.
From day one. And praise to God. I mean, we are married 52 years. And that has been the most important thing in our lives, God. My kids, we were blessed with 4 kids, but the good Lord took away one. And we raised them, teach them, we taught them how to love God, you know, always going to church as a family, always moving with them as a family. In prayer, in whatever we did, it was always a family. We never traveled without them. And we tried our best to bring them up the best we could, knowing God. Which I am happy that up to now, my kids still, you know, I feel well, they're still close to God, you know. And when I go visit them, because I have 2 of them that are not here in the country, they are away, and we go visit them. They know that on Sundays, Mom, which mass would you like to go to, you know?
Take your pick.
You know, take your pick, Mom. And we would go together. I only have one that is married, the other 2 are not married. But they're wonderful sons, you know. They're very kind, they're very honest. And I seen them that Jesus is with them, you know.
Jesus is with them.
Yes, that is for sure.
Mr. Raman talks about when you have issues or problems. I mean, after 52 years, do you still have issues and problems?
Well, you know, we have gotten used now to sit down and talk. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that in marriage, that is one of the best things you can do, communicate, you know, talk about it. And don't talk about it when you are a bit annoyed. I normally wait until, if I see that he has done a mistake, you know, maybe when the kids were small, maybe he was a bit too harsh on them, I would wait until night and then I would say to him before we fall asleep, you know, Munch, I think you were a bit too aggressive with the kids, you know, that shouldn't have been done like this. We should look at it at a different way, you know? And I have realized that that worked with us, and I'm sure that it can work with everybody else in marriage, you know? And sometimes if he's, you know, with work, he's stressed out with work, you have to understand that he's tired, your husband is tired, you know? So what do you do? I used to try to get the kids into bed. I said, Daddy's tired tonight, you know. So try to be calm, okay? And always thinking about him, about, you know, his work and his health and whatnot, right? Because he was the breadwinner, for the host, right? No, we have joined together for many years now, and we have been working together, you know, for many, many years. He left, he was a banker for many years, and when he left, he said, I want to go on my own. And I was ready there for him. I said, I'm going to be your backup. I'm going to be there with you. And this is how we have been doing it for so many years like that, together.
You know, I could go on asking, and the show, the name is Ask Your Father. And I'm sure maybe the fathers have some questions for you as couples, you know, a priest. Do we find this today, 52 years of marriage? What has been your experience?
I think it's just rare in my 22 years that I can meet husband and wife who have been married for 52 years. And I witnessed a marriage many years ago, and that marriage just lasted hours, and that was the end. But for 52 years, that's unique. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Remember when you were sharing a story, one night, a couple of things caught my ears. One is you had no problems too great for your marriage. That's to say you didn't, it's not that you didn't have problems. Mm-hmm. And that's in any vocation, any love, anything that matters. It's inspiring. And that's why I think when you look at you, you realize marriage is more than just the two of you. It's more than just your family. You inspire the priestly vocation, you inspire the church, you inspire the community. It is a sacrament of grace for us. And please God, as a priest, we become something that leavens and strengthens you in your vocation. It works that way. And our church is so rich. And one thing that I think is pertinent that you're speaking about the 52 years, you said you got married cold turkey. So someone could hear that as like, well, it's marriage preparation, we should just get rid of it. And in the church language, they use a distinction in preparation between remote and immediate. Remote being everything happening from your time of your conception, all the way through your childhood, your parents, the lessons you learned, your human formation. And immediate preparation would be these 6 months in which we're talking about. So let's say your immediate preparation was lacking, but the remote preparation, the foundation, has clearly served you so well. And now the church has, in the last recent years, has spoken about this to expand its immediate preparation. About 6 months, they're saying. And some people say, why are you doing this? We didn't do this before. But one of the reasons that we're doing this is precisely because the remote preparation is lacking in more cases now. How much do we learn how to love in the school of love our family? And sometimes that remote preparation of learning to dialogue, as you talk about communication, learning to forgive, learning to be faithful, to even friendships, you know, is coming. And it seemed to me that you talk about your example of prayer and your family, the different virtues that you experienced as young people growing up, was just a gift that God and His providence was providing for you. So we as a church can rejoice with you today, 52 years after you said, I do. And so, just listen to you. There's many things that we can ponder, but those are just some of the things that I think are quite beautiful that I was pondering when you were speaking.
Fathers, either of you, married couples today, I'm sure they come to you for a lot of in counselings or issues that they face. What are some common issues that marriage face today? Maybe we could run this by the Cervantes and see their perspective and how they have dealt with similar type issues.
One of the issues that I've heard in couples is certainly has to do with what you said, communication, certainly. And that means that in marriage, what one says is not understood the way it was meant to be understood. Yeah. So it calls, at least on communication in this particular situation, it calls that, you know, that if they marry the husband and wife, that they do get to know one another to, the word would be to let the love reach its fullest in its heart, in its mind, even in the soul. You know, to understand that, to know the other person. In other words, to know meaning that when I say something to you, it's like you can read my mind, you can read my soul, you can read behind the words that I'm saying. And I think in communication, even if it's not there, you know, it's to find time to speak, and sometimes that time is lacking, or sometimes it's not understood, it's not seen. And from what I've just heard is that this person's who he or she is, it could be your attitude. It's like, no, it says, I didn't mean that. And then it would go into a whole other issues. It's like, there's no, what happened to that love? You know, just be patient, be kind, be understanding. Sometimes it's gone. You know, so it's, but communication is one of those things that I've met, you know.
That is so true. And I listened to Miss Betty talk about the right time to communicate. Because often couples, it's on my chest, I have to get it out now. And it doesn't matter how I get it out. And it comes out as sometimes very negative. But you said you wait until it's calm, the calm of the evening. Then you inform Mr. Ramon about the issues that you may have had. So maybe some of it has to do with the timing of communication also. Father Scott.
I again, going back to, you know, Ms. Betty was mentioning about, I think she said, we've come to learn to communicate. I can't remember how you precisely spoke about it. And I caught that. It's over the 52 years, they've come to learn to communicate. I think that's a normal progression, I think, with the younger couples, and to really, to have an older couple that you can go to and to kind of balance some feelings and thoughts on, it's just a great help. And I think it's quite natural that there's a little neediness or insecurity that can be in young love. It has many benefits, but there's also, it's not that fine line necessarily, right, that you can see. And that with that insecurity comes maybe rash judgments, and hesitant, like that lack of patience in communicating. And I think even more so now, though, was something that the Cervantes wouldn't have had to fight through, the obstacles to communication of social media, of the rapid pace in which we're living now. Even in the culture, I know there's certain cultures and beliefs where marriage isn't held as sacred. In fact, if they find out that a spouse is... if someone's married, it's not really held as, don't touch, it's not held as sacred or supported by the community. And so there's more, it seems like there's more obstacles, or just different obstacles, mm-hmm. especially to communication, I mean meaningful communication of the heart, as Father Chi was so beautifully speaking about. And I think that to be patient, I think we all have to be patient with ourselves. In any kind of relationship, the fact that we just come to the table to dialogue, knowing perhaps we're not where we want to be, but we're not, like the young couples out there, you're not 50 years married yet, right? And so that's okay. And the fact that we're here, we're going to talk about this, I'm not going to let go of you. There can be great healing. There can be great strengthening. And really, especially in those moments, sometimes in those crises of those marriages, you see how marriage really does sanctify the couple. You know, when you're stretched to love, when you're stretched to forgive, when you accompany another in their burdens, and I'm sure this in 52 years, there's no shortage of accompanying one another in those burdens, right? It's incredibly beautiful.
It is, no doubt. We've pretty much just scraped the top of the icing on this cake. We will get back to some more of the meat and potato. We'll go to break at this time. You're watching Ask Your Father with me. We have Father Chi and Father Scott. And Ramon and Betty Cervantes, we will be back. Welcome back. You're watching Ask Your Father with Father Scott and Father Chi, and with Ramon and Betty Cervantes. Welcome back. We left the last segment talking about, you know, some of your secrets and issues regarding long marriage. And there's a question that I have to ask Miss Betty. because it's an issue that a lot of young wives and women who contemplate getting married have issues with. It is the whole point of being submissive to your husband. You know, Ephesians 5 tells the wife, you must be submissive to your husband. How have you dealt with that concept of being submissive?
Okay. I think that comes in with humility, of being humble. You have to accept that your husband is the head of the family. Okay? And you must respect that. That doesn't mean that you have to be running just behind him or being afraid of him, you know? No. It's the way you talk to your husband, you know, with love, you know, understanding. Maybe one day he comes from work, he's tired, he has had a lot of problems, and many times, I mean, it's problems that, I mean, he cannot share with you because of his job. You have to understand that. He can't come and tell you everything he has done at work, what he's doing, you know? And that's where you come in as a wife, you know, and understand your husband, you know? Something wrong, you know, Munch, is something wrong? Aren't you feeling well, you know, in a nice tone, in a nice voice, you know? And he might say, no, I'm just tired, you know, had problems at work. Oh, well, why don't you go and take a shower? You know, maybe that would help you. Or why don't you go and lie down for a while? You know? Something like that suggests something that is soothing to him. Something that would make him, you know, feel good, you know, mentally. He's tired.
Feel good.
Makes him feel
good. And you talk about him being the head of the house.
The head of the house. You have to respect that. And that doesn't mean that he is going to tell you, woman, get up and go and do this. No. He has his way of saying, you know, I really feel for a cup of tea or, you know, a cup of coffee. Mm-hmm. And of course, I mean, you go and you get that coffee or you offer it to him, you know, if he needs something to drink or something like that, you know. And it's true, I mean, if you are a mom that stays at home and you look after the kids, I can understand that you have pressure, right? But you can make your day in such a way that maybe when daddy is about to come from work, that you have them already maybe, you know, settled, you know, help them with your homework or whatever, so that when daddy comes, they will be able to appreciate daddy. Mm-hmm. Now, if you're a working mother, then, well, that's a different story. I mean, when you come in, you say, okay, kids, you get to the shower, you do this, you do that, you know, nicely. And then you give him the time, you know. Let's go have supper together, okay? And then you get your kids together. And now when they're grown, everybody looks after their own selves, right? But when they're small, you have to share with them, you know. Share with your children. Talk to your children. Show them a lot of love. That's where, I mean, the unity comes in, when you give a lot of love. I always remember my mom saying, if you give love, you receive love. I always remember that. And that's why even when you're out on the streets, it's nice to say to somebody, old, young, whoever, good morning, you know, how are you this morning, you know, because that's showing a bit of love to those people, even though you might not know them. It doesn't have to be a person that you know. And many times, I mean, you have people there that are longing for love. Just a nice word to them. They're longing for love. They don't have love. They don't have anybody to give them love. You know? So, and I strongly feel that, I mean, we should be loving not only to our own, but to other people outside of our house.
That is so true. I'd like to hear from Mr. Cervantes about this headship thing and how have you dealt with it? When did you figure it out and how has it been?
A word love. is a very powerful word. It comes from God. God loves us. God doesn't rough us up. God takes care of us. We respect God, but even though God is Almighty, God respects us in a way. People don't think so when they have hard times, but yes, my wife always gives me my place in the family, as the head of the family, but we have no boss. There's no boss in our family. We're lovers, we're companions, we're friends, we look after each other. We dialogue.
No boss.
No boss. I'll give you an example. Many years ago, a hard sales foreigner came in selling encyclopedias in the bank. And the bank allowed him to approach a different staff. And after I wanted the encyclopedias, it set so bad for my children coming up. And I said to him, you know, after lunch I will tell you, I need to go home and consult with my wife. He's hard sales. And he said, oh, you're one of those men that your wife have you under her feet. I said, thank you very much. I'm not going to buy your encyclopedias. I wouldn't let anybody get in between me and my wife. We're going to live loving. We're going to live according to God's plan. We're going to help each other. One simple thing, men always have this macho thing about them. When we just got married, the bank transferred me abroad, 3,000 miles away, no family, no real friends, and she brought forth the first child, and she caught what you call a baby cold when the mother is delivering. She catches a cold, which is hard to get rid of. And before the sun gets hot in the mornings, she would take out the baby's clothes and give it to me. I would go downstairs, put it in the washing machine, wash it, and dry it, and then go off to work. When the sun gets hot, she would get up and put it on the line. And some of my colleagues saw me doing that, and they made fun of me, but I didn't care. We're partners. I love this woman. I love this child that she brought forth. That's my child. And that has been our life all along. Help each other. Don't feel, oh, I'm the man, so I'm going to watch this basketball game.
Bring the bear.
And yeah, no. That has never been. And I would like to tell couples, when you talk about being submissive, yes, the wife would always come to the husband and say, you know, darling, there's something or the other that we have to do, and I want to know what you think about it. And then he in turn would say, well, this is what I think, but I also want your input. After all, we are in this together. I think that has been one of the main things that we have lasted 52 years. There's no boss.
That is such valuable information, Mr. Ramon. You know, I myself, I'm pushing 20 years of marriage, and I am still learning. I am very grateful that you're here. And it is my prayer that other young people who are married are watching the show and could learn from you. But I'd like to ask the priest to put this submissive question into perspective. I know it's a part of a scripture, and it just didn't say, women be submissive, or wives be submissive to your husbands. It's a part of the scripture. So maybe they could break it down for us so we could really get the true sense.
Okay. I think Mrs. Petit and Mr. Ramon said the key word, which is love.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if somebody loves you, you will freely, as you say, give yourself you surrender yourself. You won't question nothing negative, nothing bad, free will. That's what leads two persons, a man and a woman, into marriage. So submission in that context, in the context of love, where there's truth, where there's sincerity, where there's respect, where you know that, you know, we're going to work so that this union, this love can bloom and not die. We see that even in children, you know, they submit to their parents, but it's nothing negative. So the submission becomes actually a way of expressing your love, your trust to the one that you love. And Paul, you know, he had gone from, you know, persecuting the church to finally give himself to the church. And what he was talking about, he was talking about Jesus Christ. Paul knew the story of the prophets who, for the love of God, they had faith in God. They even surrendered their lives freely, you know, whatever test came. They knew that this God was going to be there, even in trials, even if they were facing death. They knew that this love. And Paul, who we know as Saul became Paul, he says, nothing will ever separate us from the love. He truly believed that for him to submit to God, that was no question. So in the context of marriage, I think what is, you know, it's a call for the husband and the wife, you know, to let that love, when God raises it to the level of a sacrament, to work with grace, that the word submission doesn't mean you're giving away of your rights, that you're giving away of your dignity, that you're being a slave. No, it's not giving, it's happiness. Now, when that does not exist, I think that's something else. Then we will be afraid that submission means, you know, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do, and that's not what Scripture says.
Yeah, submissive is only threatening if the backdrop is in love. I guess on Christmas, sometimes people give a new paint job to the house. You have the same house, same furniture, and you go and paint with a different color. It can be a completely different house. All you did is just change the color. Whole different feel to it, emotionally, everything. You know? And so likewise, if that word submissive has a backdrop of our fallen nature, of competition, of manipulation and aggression, well, yeah, submissive is going to look very ugly. But if that backdrop is love, the most holy Trinity, that same word becomes something rejoicing. It's funny, you have a whole list, you give a married couple a list of readings that they can choose. You know, some couples avoid that passage. They don't want to go there. But then those married couples, the brides that have come to understand the beauty of this and see the wisdom of this submissiveness to her husband, and the husband laying down their lives as Christ laid down his life for this church, they recognize the beauty of it. This is Jesus reigns at the heart of the Most Holy Trinity. It's the foundation of the love for the family, for society, the church, everything. But what I don't understand is why there's so much conflict, even if people don't see that. Because the verse before, you know, it can be submissive or subordinate, a different translation. But St. Paul introduces that whole phrase, but be subordinate to one another of reverence for Christ. The verse right before it. And so even if someone was struggling with their faith and didn't know the encounter of Jesus' love, it seems that it's such a wound in our heart that sometimes we can only see problems, even with the Word of God. And it happens in marriages. And so sometimes if we're seeing those problems or something of threatening or aggression or manipulation, the challenge very often isn't the people around us. Sometimes it's right within our own heart. And so we really have to pray to the Holy Spirit. When we pray to the Holy Spirit, there's a certain healing of hearts that we need. You know, that we don't have to, because if we don't have a healed hearts, whether it be a marriage or a religious vocation in the church, we'll even see the love of Jesus as threatening. We see the cross as threatening.
You're so right, Father Scott. And the key thing is, particularly for husbands, to not to get caught up on this headship thing, because it could really throw them off. I listened to Miss Betty talk about how she lovingly assisted her husband on days that was kind of stressful. And I listened to Mr. Ramon talk about how he helped his wife in non-traditional ways, because she's his partner. So there's that love. There's that love. But these guys that, you know, wife must be submissive to me, missed the boat, you know. And Father Scott says it. Says that, and Christ also asked that you, husbands, willing to lay down your life for your wife, your bride.
Of course.
And once the wife understands that, it becomes the story becomes a lot easier, a lot better. All right, we've again covered quite a bit there. We'll go to break. You're watching Ask Your Father. We will be back. We're back to Ask Your Father with Father Chi and Father Scott, and with us the Cervantes, Petty and Ramon. Welcome. Mr. Ramon had a question. Mr. Ramon, I'll give you the mic to ask your question to the priest.
No, I just wanted to find out what the priest, their take is on. Little children in church, say during a mass, I know from my experience that you have some priests that don't care if the child is making noise. They don't want you to keep the child away from church. They want you to bring the child to church. Okay. We had an experience of another priest that would say, get that child out of my church. The same way you got a babysitter to go to a party, you can get a babysitter to come to church. And I found that rather strange in the context of Jesus Christ that said, suffer the little children and let them come on to me. So that has always puzzled me. Yes, the child might be distracting the proceedings of the mass in a way, but do we keep them away or do we bring them to church from small? That's the question.
I think one of the best ways to do, yes, you know, it's, I have seen that actually. I also see that, in fact, I believe that the marriage is the domestic church, meaning that's the first setting where a child is going to receive the first teaching of love, about God, about prayers. And so when the parents take a child to church and begins to get rowdy or noise, one of the best things to do is, you know, just get the child, perhaps go outside until the child is calm, and afterwards you go back. The harm is that if, you know, if we ask the parents to get the child out, the harm is kind of great. And what could have become a moment of teaching, a moment of embrace that you're still here? It kind of like, it kind of goes low. In fact, everybody's welcome in the church to worship, because then you're right that Jesus did say, let the children come to me. And in fact, our blessed mother, Joseph, they welcomed Jesus into their family. And we know that blessed mother and Joseph did take Jesus to the temple, to the synagogues, for him to learn, to read, to know about the Psalms, about the prophets, you know, about the book of Genesis, and the Pentateuch, Exodus, and all of those things. So they were what we call the domestic church. And Jesus did say to, do you not know that I should be in my Father's house? So we should We should take that Jesus wants to be. So we have to find ways, you know, to be, as I said, pastoral, to be loving, to embrace, and not to, you know, to kind of like push them away. But you're right. I think the thing is, I always remember that everybody's welcome, but sometimes the answers don't come that fast, and you know.
So I think your question is more for the liturgy than about the children. Mm-hmm. Because I'm sure if you ask that same priest, don't you love children? He wouldn't say, no, I don't like children. I'm sure he loves children. I think the tension, and it happens a lot with different priests, different churches, mm-hmm. different experiences that we may have as faithful. We belong to one church. And there's a certain tension that we have. And it's a healthy tension because we're so universal, different cultures and different experiences, but one faith. And so in the tension, I think we should always be mindful of being familiarity with God, and to have a reverence with God. And so this is the tension that we may have. Our different temperaments, our upbringings, we may tend to be more familiar, more kind of laid back, more, this is my home, this is a meal, right? Or we have different background and experience, we can maybe tend to more reverence. This is the sacrifice of Christ. This is our blood. He sheds his blood for our sins, and maybe whatever it may be. So we want to just make sure we stay within those boundaries which we go. Now, we go too much, to become too familiar, well, there's certain things that just are wrong. Yeah. Or we can become too reverent, so to speak, where you don't even see your neighbor anymore and lose basic charity. So I think we would say, yeah, we want children there. But I don't think you'd want the child crawling on the altar, you know.
No.
Someone could say, well, let the children come to Jesus. And so there's a certain cultural boundary in which we want to move. And there's a gray area there, you know, because I guess one the first priest that you mentioned maybe emphasized the familiarity, the familiar aspect. And maybe the other priest was trying to emphasize the reverence element of the liturgy. Perhaps the way things could be done could always be improved every time. So in general, though, if you're asking personally, I would say we want the children to get used to seeing Jesus as often as possible. There are certain churches I've heard that during the liturgy of the word, they have a children's service that is according to there, and then they come back from the Eucharist. And that there's some benefit to that, too. There's some ways to manage that tension. There's other pastoral difficulties, and like finding teachers, and it takes time. But I do get red flags go up when couples say, I don't go to church because my baby, I can't keep him still. Right? And in that moment, I think that's a major temptation. I really do. Because who is the parent there? Now, parents, forgive me, I know it's difficult, right? I know it takes sometimes years, but a child won't learn how to go to church if he doesn't go. I think what you're touching upon too, we as a community have to have certain suffer the children. We have to be patient, especially for our young families, to make room for those inconveniences as children learn. And we want to do whatever we can to make that happen.
I would just like to add what happened.
Sure.
The first priest in Guyana, when that happened, that the child became kind of rowdy, she would go to Mass and I would stay home with the child. And I would go to Mass later on. And the priest got after her one morning. He says, where is your husband and the child? And she explained, he said, no, 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 no. I want you to keep coming to church as a family. As a family.
He said,
I don't want you to split.
Definitely.
So it puzzled me. Anyway, thanks for the answer.
That's fine. That's fine. Because indeed, it is a pressure, particularly on couples who are with young children. Because I remember, you know, we have a 15 and 13-year-old now. And when they were babies, so at one time, one was not even two and the next one was a baby. So we had young kids. And my wife used to get stressed out at Mass time. And I'm sure at some point, if I wasn't strong, that's to say that we would keep going to Mass, we would have taken that break as well. Because, you know, it brings a lot of attention on you. And then when the baby starts, people start gazing at you. And my wife does not like attention. So I would be the one to take over and, you know, pack the baby and walk back at the Mass whenever the church. But we have to stick with it. And it goes back to what Father Chi said about your domestic church. In the home, when you have your prayer session, the children must know from then that they must be reverent. And so when you go to church, likewise, that reverence would translate because it's the same God. So good question, though. Excellent question. 52 years ago, you got married in Corozal. Tell us about that. Who was the priest? And talk to us about that day.
52 years ago, there was a dynamic priest in Corozal that built a beautiful church. But he didn't stay too long. That was Father Martin Avila. He was transferred to the United States.
Yes.
And then they brought in a more dynamic. First one was dynamic, this one was super dynamic. Young priest by the name of at the time he didn't use the name Osmond Peter. It was Father Frank Martin.
Frank Martin.
Yes. And we approached him as pastor and asked to be married. And he had a very solemn nuptial mass for us. And I think he must have used a lot of God's glue, some special glue. I say it's God's glue.
God's glue, obviously.
Because it's nothing dark. Has been able to come in between us. Mm-hmm. Nothing. And we have kept, from that time, we have kept close to God. After I got married, I stopped going out with my friends. I told them you could come home and have a little drink or two. But my inspiration was, this is your wife. This is where you should be. Not out somewhere else, walking around aimlessly.
Of course.
And because she was a woman of prayer, from then, we always had prayer as a family.
I would like to
always just,
yes, so true.
Family prayer.
To say that, and that Frank Martin, Father Frank Martin, also Osmond Peter Martin,
Peter
became the first Belizean bishop.
That's right.
For the country, and he has gone home to be with our Lord. And we're mourning at this time.
Yes.
So that must mean something to both of you.
Oh, of course. The priest. Of course. The first thing that came to us was this man really had a calling from God. First of all, to be a priest. And second of all, to be the first bishop in Belize. Belizean bishop. And we're happy for him. We know, we're sure that he now has gone to his final reward.
Amen.
Yes.
Did you guys keep in touch with him through the years?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Did he know that 50 years later you guys were still together? And
yeah, we kept in touch with him until he left.
Great.
Bishopric, yes. At least kept in touch with him.
May his soul rest in peace.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
As we come to the end of our show, would like to give some advice. I'm sure you have some advice, some recommendations for young married couples or for couples thinking about getting married, young children. And maybe before we get to that though, you have sons, three sons. There are four you mentioned, and the Lord, one went home to the Lord, and you had to raise them. And as married couples for so long, you realize that you have a legacy that you want to leave with them. What would you say is that legacy? What do they learn from you when it comes to your spirituality about God, your children and your grandchildren?
Well, I always tell my kids that God's supposed to be first in their lives. course in their lives. And then, and always to remember that as long as they keep close to God, they will be able to solve all the problems that come on them in life. Because it's only through Him that we get the strength, the love, the understanding towards other people. It's only through God we can do that. It's not something that we can make. It's something that He has to give us. And the only way we can get it if we ask Him for what we want, what we need.
It's the importance of prayer.
That is the importance of prayer. Pray. And I really, really believe in prayer. God never fails us, never. And I look at life when I pray, sometimes I'm praying for a certain thing, you know, my kids or my grandchildren or even friends that ask me to pray for them, and it doesn't come the way that I am thinking it might. I always say, Lord, you know best. And in my life, I have noticed that whatever the Lord sends as an answer is always the best. Many times what you're asking for is not what you ask for. He sends it in a different way and in a better way, you know, for whoever you are praying for. You know,
prayer, important.
Prayer is so powerful. I can tell you it is powerful. I am here today because the good Lord didn't want to take me when I thought He was. I was very sick like that.
Suffered a stroke in April 2011.
Yes. And everybody, my sons being doctors, they knew that I wasn't going to live. But the good Lord came to me, and I could remember good. I think I should share it with you all.
Yes, please do.
That I found myself, I was seeing myself on a hospital bed. This is when I was unconscious. And all of a sudden, I saw a man coming towards me. And when the man got close to my bed, he leaned over me and he looked me into the eyes. That was my dream, or whatever it was, you know. And when I came back, that the doctors said that I was not going to live, I came back. And the morning that the doctor said, Mrs. Cervantes, I think I'm going to send you home today. And I held on to him and I said, I have a question for you. And he said, go ahead. I said, at any moment when I was in this coma, did I sing? And the doctor watched me straight and then he held my two hands together. And he said, Mrs. Cervantes, you are a miracle. That's all he said. You are a miracle. And then I understood. I said, you have answered my question. Because when this man looked into my eyes, I remember seeing myself singing. You know? And I do remember what I sang. And he just said, you are a miracle. So I know that the Lord did come to me, look me into my eyes. When I got home, I always keep a little album because I have a niece that is a nun. And every time she visits, all she brings are little pictures, you know, same pictures. So I open an album and I put all these pictures. And when people sometimes ask me, Miss Betty, you don't have a picture of Saint so-and-so, I look up my album and if I have it, I give it to them. So when I got home, I picked up this album and I said, I have to find out whose eyes I saw. And I looked through. And it was the Good Shepherd and, you know, all about Jesus, Jesus' eyes. But when I came to the Divine Mercy eyes, I realized that it was the Divine Mercy's eyes that looked into my eyes. So I am very confident that it was the divine mercy that brought me back.
You are looking at Jesus, the good shepherd. The divine mercy.
How profound.
And you recognize that
it was the divine mercy's eyes.
Thank you for sharing that. Yeah, that is quite a way to end our show. I asked, for any advice, but you've been giving advice all through this session. And it seems, fathers, if I'm not wrong, importance of prayer.
That's what Jesus says. Pray, 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 pray.
Pray, pray, pray.
And prayer leads us to the Eucharist where we find Jesus.
And that is the take home from this show. And the prayer led to the miracle that you're talking about. So couples, young couples, middle couples, older couples, prayer. Pray, pray, pray. We come to the end of our show. It's been a short one, I know. We'd like to say thank you to Ms. Petty and Mr. Rabban. This young couple, they attend marriage enrichment evenings. They attend retreats as much as they could. They were at the retreat a couple weeks ago where we, with some other couples. So they also know the value of working on their marriage. It just doesn't happen like that. You have to invest the time. This couple, they're humble enough. They didn't share, but they also prepare young couples to be married from the parish of St. Joseph. So again, in these preparations, I'm sure, like Loretta and I, my wife, every couple we get, it's a time for us to renew our own marriage. So it keeps getting richer. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you too for having us
here. Thank you for saying yes.
Thank you.
We'd also like to say thanks to Father Chi and Father Scott. Thank you, Father. You got off the hook this time. Because the questions were more geared towards our young couple. We'd like to thank you for being with us, watching our show. We'd like to say thanks to Guadalupe Media, who produced this show. I am your host, Vincent Palacio. Thank you.